Imagine Dragons. First of all, we'd like to take this opportunity to thank you for your time and to invite us along today to present to you our idea. We are, as we said, Masters of the Universe. Before we introduce ourselves, I just want to let you know what we're talking to you about today. We would like to introduce a new role into retail. It will be an expert role. The idea is to improve customer service levels, reduce PTC, and overall improve NPS for the business and generate a little bit of revenue. On that, we will introduce ourselves. My name is Sarah. I am the assistant manager from EE Store in Paul.
Hi, Ryan. My name is Akida. I'm the assistant store manager from Reading Broad Street.
Hello, my name is Jordan. I'm from Southampton West Key as a sales advisor.
Hello, I'm Fadus. I'm the assistant manager of White City Romeo 514.
Good afternoon. My name is Pat. I'm a sales advisor from Bishop Store.
Hello, I'm Antoine from Oxford Street, Romeo 634, assistant manager.
Hello, I'm Danny, I'm the assistant manager of Bright School, Romeo 126.
And hi, I'm Ryan, I'm the assistant manager of Southern School.
Thanks. First of all, we're going to hand over to Akila, who's going to talk to you a little bit about ADAF's plan from 2014 and into 2015.
Thank you, Sarah. That's right. So behind me, there's a passage from ADAF's vision and message for 2015. And this passage really applies to what we're going to talk to you guys today. 2014, Olaf said 2014 was good. So what made us good? As you guys all know, and we all know, EE Way took a massive form in our stores for our customers and our advisors. What did that do? That also is being continuously measured through Mystery Shop and MPS. Retail mobile transaction is also in trial, and bookable appointments has also gone live. So if that's what's made us good, what is going to make us the best? Continuously talk about being best, being bold, and being brilliant. We need to get into the detail of what it is that's going to make that difference and what we can do. So we're a part of the problem, but we also want to be a part of the solution. I'm going to pass you back over to Sarah for some more detail.
Okay, thanks, Akila. So we wanted to improve service levels. We were quite unanimous about that decision. So when the big presentation came up, the first idea was to introduce something into retail. Service is the most important thing alongside our great network. It's the key to our customers coming back in to see us. It's also the key to gaining new customers to join our network. Our current customers have chosen EE. They've chosen us to connect them to all the technology and all of the people that matter to them the most. It's absolutely important that we return this commitment. It's a relationship, it's a promise. I'm now gonna hand you over, no I'm not, sorry. I'm going to talk to you about the current reality. So we did a little bit of digging. As you can see from our slide there, this is from Mystery Shop Wave, December 2014. What clearly stands out is the Be There When I Need You section at 21%. The rest aren't exactly where we want them to be, but that for us is going to be the biggest thing that we can work with, and we feel that the EE Expert could really, really move that towards the 85 up to 100% that we would look for. Now I'm going to hand you over to Jordan to talk to you a bit more about research.
Great. So behind me, I have a lovely table here, which is taken from a Which survey in 2014. What this table is showing us is just a comparison of what the public think of our network at the moment in comparison to others. Now, I've removed a number of networks from this, such as GIFGAF, Tesco, because mobile virtual network operators don't have the same costs as being associated with main providers like us. So to compare, we think is a bit unjust. So we've narrowed it down to the four networks. However, EE is still ranking in the bottom, which is something we don't like to see. Now, our main stumbling points come to value of money, ease of contacting, and customer service. Now, it's important to note this survey was taken in February 2014. So the fact that we're rated 2 out of 5 in value of money, we don't think is very fitting, because after the survey, we introduced our great new pay-as-you-go packs and own brand devices such as the Kestrel and the Eagle to roll out this great value 4G to the masses. So I'm going to ignore that for a little bit. We want to focus on the customer service and ease of contacting, because O2 is currently the leader in this area, according to the public, getting 4 out of 5 stars in comparison to 1, 2, and 3. So we want to see, was this just an anomaly, or are other customers saying different things in different surveys? Unfortunately, it's been a trend. We also looked at the UK Consumer Satisfaction Index, called I'm on one map. On that one, O2 again is at number one. Now, we're not bottom on that one, we're penultimate, but again, that's not the number one that we're striving for. A bit more information, we looked into the number of complaints networks are getting. Again, EE, the unfortunately is getting 0.12 per 1,000 customers. Now, it doesn't sound a lot, but the industry average is 0.06. O2, currently getting 0.04. Makes a bit of sense the fact that OLAF wants to reduce our complaints down to 0.03 out of 1,000 this year, because that would take us to industry leader. If we take a step back, the Which survey, you know, outside of just mobile networks in general, the Which survey for top 100 best and worst retailers, the fact that we've unfortunately become equated with is that we are 96th, joining the 99p store, it's been thrown around a little bit. It's not something we'd like to see. However, Carphone Warehouse, a company that is selling our product in our network, are at 26. Again, it's not number one, but what is it that O2 and Carphone are doing differently that we're not offering to our customers at the moment? Because clearly something is working. So we looked into it, and these companies are dedicating a service line to their customers to come into store where they can look into their problems with their handsets and with their account. So using this information, we channeled that into an exit survey for our customers. Within the exit survey, the main basis was, would you like to see a dedicated technical advisor in store to help you with your issues? The answer, 97% of customers said yes. And within our feedback, we had some quotes passed around like, why don't you have this already? Do you not already offer this kind of personalized service in store, which realistically, we don't at the moment. We then looked into a little bit further just to explore the cost side of things. Would customers be willing to pay for this? Wasn't as unanimous. 27% said they'd be willing to get a personalized service from us, but largely, they don't want to pay for it too much. So we've had to take all of this into consideration when looking into our problem. I'm now going to hand you over to Ryan, who's going to talk about the problem a little bit more.
Good afternoon. So looking after all of this, what we'd like to introduce today is the following. An EE expert. So, why do we need an EE expert? As Jordan was saying earlier, our mystery shop results are not where they should be, with the biggest focus being there around EE. We all know our service is not where it needs to be, and our experts will bridge the gap between sales and aftercare. So the EE's main vision, we also want to have experts to maintain EE's vision of being number one for customer service. And we also want to provide the full package and acknowledge the importance of aftercare. So why next? Let's look at rivals. You may be thinking, I've seen something like this before, Go-To Guru. We want to be number one for service in the UK. So we need a first point of call for customers. We need to avoid needless repair bookings and reduce calls to CS and RIA. As Jordan was saying earlier, this is the UK Customer Satisfaction Index. As you can see, O2 are ranked top now, and we are ranked third. O2 earned 6 points for their O2 Guru service. If we had similar service to Guru, we would move from third join top with O2, and as E comes before O, we will be top. And finally, this will introduce happy customers and loyal customers. And what do loyal customers do? They are repeat customers who have enjoyed the experience in store. They believe more in our products from us, and they promote the products to their friends. I'm now going to patch on to Badoos, who's going to go for it.
Thank you, Ryan. So, the EE expert, or the role as such, has been thought about before and researched, and our point of contact in the company did say that the reason they didn't really take it on is they didn't actually look at any chargeable options for our customers. So, taking all of the research that we did into consideration and a lot of our own thoughts and feelings around this, we've got a table just behind me that there'll be three different packages. So no customer is left out from this personalised service. So all our customers will be able to have this as a free service for a 20-minute bookable appointment that can be done on the app that they have on their phones, where it also locates the local stores. The second option was that it will be a free benefit to our current insurance and protection customers, so they can benefit from this as well. The third option was a 12-month subscription of £2.50 a month or a £20 one-off fee. Just to put that into context, the one-off £20 fee, if we were to get 100,000 customers to sign up, that's a £2 million
So what I'm going to plan to talk about is repairs and PTC. Approximately 20,000 repairs are sent off to SVE every month. 30% could have been resolved in store with a software update laptop. That actually amounts to 72,000 resolvable repairs a year. The average cost of a repair being sent off is £15. Now, the potential reduction of 72,000 devices being dispatched will represent an estimate saving of £1,080,000 a year. These are the top reasons customers call customer service and drive PTC. Now, these can all be resolved through an expert, especially the main three highlighted, as you can see. Okay, happier customers call less, therefore saving us money. We will have a potential saving of £3 million a month in OPEX if EE had the same PTC as O2. That's £36 million in a year. Happier customers cost £20 less to serve plus customers as well. Now, during H2 2014, PTC was highest amongst call center joiners for buying and setup performance. We can utilize this knowledge to close the gap between CS and retail, as CS will offer customers the option for a brilliant setup through our experts, which is something CS lacks. It is well known that customers who are provided a welcome wallet saw a reduction in PTC, increase in NPS. Bringing additional footfall into store can also lead to incremental sales. The service success we are expecting, NPS will move towards our aspirational goal of 85%, improve customer retention, reduction in PTC, improve pulse results for working together. Mystery section of Be There When I Need You will improve beyond 50% by the end of 2015 and ultimately reach up to 80% end of 2016. Now, what are the financial gains? Reduction in repairs costs roughly around £1,080,000 a year. Insurance strike rate of 40%. A subscription, the expert subscription rate of 1,000, a minimum of 1,000 by the end of 2015. Incremental sales, as 50% of expert interactions should result into additional sales. Thank you very much, and off to Ryan. Sorry.
Thanks, Felice. So we know that there's a need for this, and we know that we've got great people in our stores already, and we know that we can deliver on this if we've got the right people in the roles. So the role of a customer advisor is very, very diverse, and they accommodate some of the features of an EE expert we'll address, such as billing inquiries, software updates, direct debit details, so on. And always at the back of the mind, speaking from personal experience, I've got a target. I need to hit some figures, I need to make money for the company. And that doesn't give me the best time that I can have with a customer. The other thing is, how on earth am I supposed to be up to date with the cutting edge technologies when I do this as a day job? My customer can come home, check out Apple's latest releases, they go on GSM Arena. It's a lot to take on for one person. So, ideally, we can focus on strengths within teams. You might have someone that doesn't aspire to be a store manager because maybe they feel they're not as sales orientated, not as numbers driven. Perfect. Aspire to be an EE expert. We'll take your customer service skills and enhance them. It will leave the sales team more time to spend with customers. Dig into their digital lives. Find out about their television, their broadband, the tablets they have at home. See if their nan's okay. Do they FaceTime to Australia? All of these options. And then you have your EE expert as a hub of the up-to-date information that's going on in the industry at the moment. In March, we've got the Mobile World Conference. Potentially our experts could be on the Twitter feeds and so forth, dealing out this information to our staff. It's ideal. How that translates into a business, taking all we've discussed there on the focus of the strengths, you can then enhance the shop itself on the high street. We become a one-stop shop for every customer. They can come in from A through to Z of the transaction, we'll be there. Absolutely, it will build a relationship within the community. We will be trusted because we'll know what we're talking about. And finally, it will be a physical embodiment of OLAS vision for being number one for service and being there for their digital lives. So hopefully we'll find someone that wants to be an EE expert. Hopefully they'll do it for free, though this is unlikely. So we are looking at some numbers, and we want to put it in the same position as perhaps a senior sales role, around about 17,500 as a salary. Recruiting them internally, it's around about £1,000. External, around about £4,000. Obviously, if you do take a sales advisor and you promote them to an EE expert, then there's a backfill of position needed as well. So if you encompass the new role created, the benefits that that includes, say national insurance, the backfilling of a position, approximately per EE expert, £54,000 to implement in the top, say, stores. That being said, if you offset against that the cost savings it can bring to the store and the increased revenue, it's a very worthwhile investment. I'm going to pass you over to Antoine, who's going to talk a little bit more about the actual role itself. So, thank you.
Cheers, Matt. Hi, Matt. Role of an EE expert. As we all know, some of these roles have been currently in store, but we're not where we're supposed to be, as it shows on our NPS score. The role of an EE expert would be brilliant in store, basically to help improve the Be There When I Need You section of the EE journey. Okay, and also that will help the sales advisors to perform their role better, basically. Customers will be able to get full health check on devices to identify faults in store before being sent away. As well, I know 30% of answers have been sent needlessly to SBS, which can be resolved in store. E-experts will be able to carry out warranty software repairs in store that will help reduce, will be cost effective. Software upgrades can be carried out in store during or after upgrades sales. Contents can be transferred for upgrading customers, but doing so will help service customer service advisor again to perform their roles more efficiently in store. E-experts will be able to have one-to-ones to enable customers to get the most from their devices, i.e. we've seen how the tech team party was successful in store. Why not have this on a daily basis for customers? By doing this, it will help reduce the calling into customer service teams, which will in turn reduce PTC for the company. Okay, so I'll pass you over to Dan, who will talk a little bit more about the training section.
Hi guys. Now you probably have a question on your mind. How are we going to make sure these EE experts are ready to maintain and deliver only the best customer service? So let me tell you. We already have a fantastic range of existing tools at our disposal help me get these guys ready for the challenge. Starting with the e-house modules. The e-house modules are a great source of base information to get our guys up to spec on everything EE, from policy and process to the latest devices, software and OS, and compliance. Next up is the manufacturer reps. This is a vitally underutilized asset that comes into our stores on a day-to-day basis with a wide range of knowledge from the past, present, and future devices coming to our ever-changing market. Now, they also bring with them a lot of external training through zones such as Xperia Zone and Samsung Backstage. I rarely ever see guys in stores going through these on a regular basis, making sure they're up to scratch with those and their own EE house modules. Now, with great power comes great responsibility. Systems training. Our guys are potentially going to be dealing with not only device queries, but account queries as well. So with that, they're going to need full systems training on JTI, CSS, and Excalibur. We already get a little bit of that in store as it is now, but we will need to utilise potentially the super users to help make sure these guys are up to spec and ready to go. Now also, you may be aware, occasionally there can be a little bit of friction between customer service and retail. When this does happen, the customer doesn't always get the best customer service in store. So I propose to use a buddy system once per quarter, where we send someone from retail to buddy up with someone to CS, and someone to CS to buddy up with someone from retail to help understand current frustrations and issues each other are going through. So the next time there is a system outage or a company-wide issue, this doesn't affect the customer, and we still delight our customers every day. When are they going to appear? We propose an initial rollout to start in H2. Our ideal goal is to see an EE expert in all of our top 160 stores. We know that doesn't happen overnight. So what we propose at the start of H2 is 5 stores initially. How we will gauge those 5 stores will be inconsistent or underperforming top 160 stores based on their NPS scores. We're going to do a few range of monitoring them, monitoring the overall store's NPS score, the customer verbatim, and the amount of repairs sent off from each store. And by using this, we will then gauge a further rollout in quarter four, how many stores to push on for, and then potentially go into 16 to gauge that as well. Thank you for listening. I'm going to hand you over to Akila to talk to you about where the future role will go.
Thank you, Dan. So the EE brand, as we all know, our customers know, and our advisors in store, is very strong as it is. But just like the brand and just like the industry, it's ever evolving, and so will be our role. So we've already looked at things like YouTube, which is already at our disposal, but we're not using it. Just to put that into context, O2 are currently racking up 1 million views on their online tutorials and workshops. That's an absolute massive gap in the market we've got where we're not taking our customers on. Bookable appointments, already we've got the app which shows where the local store is, but that's where we'll be able to get on and book these appointments with our EE expert. And then educating the public and getting them back into our stores for a positive experience and obviously the sales, that's just a never-ending story. So it's all good. I'm going to pass you back over to Pat.
Thanks, Akila. So we know we've got the ROV, we know we've got the people, we know that financially from our point of view it can work. Closing thought for you. Our customer is the most important visitor on our premises. He is not dependent on us. We are dependent on him. He is not a distraction to our work. He is the purpose of it. He is not an outsider in our business. He is part of it. We're not doing him a favour by serving him. He is doing us a favour by giving us the opportunity to do so.
Thank you very much for your time, Dragons. We would now like to invite your questions and answers. And your, you know, kind of digital behind it, and because you come from the shop floor, you know what you're talking about. I feel compelled to listen to it. I feel you got me like really at the start and thought, yeah, and then you lost me a bit. I'll tell you why you lost me a bit, but you've got me back again, so don't worry too much. I think you're trying to do too much with this, you know, so I think you're along the spectrum of a whole level of expertise there, and you've gone everything from usage into some repair area, which we should be doing anyway now, you know, kind of some of those things, then into warranty software repairs and into kind of screen fixes or kind of really hardware stuff. So where you've got me more is on the upper end, because I do think that's something that we don't attend to at the minute at all. On the lower end and the kind of the lower spec stuff, you know, and this is your opportunity to challenge me back. My belief is that if you try and put that into one person, one expert, in X hours a day in Y stores, then you lose the real differential of your brand, whereby we're accessible for that kind of lower level of be there when I need you. So whatever that cutoff is on the spectrum, I would like us to hold that more in our stores, whereby all of our stores offer a level of expertise. But then what I'd love to probe a bit more with you is how some of our stores could offer even more expertise.
So it is something we looked at. I mean, rolling out on the finances to over 700 stores would be astronomical. Smaller stores wouldn't have the FTE perhaps to have a permanent expert. So if there was a near top 160 store, potentially you could have satellite appointments. So the expert would spend a day a week in a couple of different stores, if possible, to sort of reach out to the smaller stores, as it were. So it is something we did discuss in our prep, but as you say, it's such a broad spectrum. There's so much to cover, we could literally be here all day.
We didn't really want to focus too much on like hardware
try and get a sale out of me, they're here to genuinely help me rather than get my money, essentially.
Yeah, you want the purest motivation,
yeah,
and
exactly.
Then the sale comes great, but you don't want them to feel that's the only way
exactly.
It gets
sales. But then kind of at the same time be like, oh, your iPhone, that thing, so you're like kind of getting those, like planting the seed almost, kind of then like grow the potential sales out of them, was kind of what we were looking for a bit more.
Okay. Okay. And bookable appointments, how important is that to you as a tenancy?
It would be quite important. We were looking at using that. That was kind of a massive focus of it, because we rarely ever see, if you walk into a retail store now, you're not going to see an advisor book an appointment to help out the person they served a week ago set up their phone. Doesn't really happen. People just don't do it. Guarantee if you go around to the stores, it'll all be sales based booked appointments or an issue based booked appointment that they really need to get sorted, and that's kind of like a last straw. So like book appointments with this, it takes, you know, the stress away. If I set your phone up today but I'm not in tomorrow, like you need a little bit of help that I can give you today, and you come back in and see somebody else, the natural sort of mentality with the customer advisor is, oh, this is, you know, Dan's issue from yesterday, he's got help now, I don't really help him, and they don't get the best customer service. So if you had someone dedicated to that, you know they're going to get the best customer service, because that's all they do all day, is just give good customer service. And that way, you know, you're eliminating potentially a lot of neutrals that we see. We see a lot of neutrals come back for silly little queries, you know, like, didn't put my SIM in the phone, or, you know, set my phone up brilliantly, but I was unsure about this, and then when I went back in, you know, nobody really wanted to show me how, or they were busy, you know, they put me on the phone to customer service, and that's the element that we want to really reduce this.
And just a final question for me, on that upper end of the spectrum where it is kind of, you know, the sort of the hardcore, kind of maybe the hardware stuff, did you consider outsourced partners with that?
We obviously the relationship we got with SBE at the moment would carry on. They potentially, something that we looked at was if they are getting fewer repairs and the actual hardware fixes could potentially be speeded through as well, so that would again help with the customer satisfaction from repairs. There is, we touched on it very, very lightly, the potential for doing hardware repairs in the store, but this is obviously far off into the future, the cost, the implications, the training, having the parts. It would be something we'd have to address once we knew that the base level of customer service and improving NPS sales, etc., could sort of make it viable, basically. We did
think there's some quite good companies, Pat, that actually provide that and would come into our shop. You could come into, there's a company we're actually working with, one of the companies, and they've pulled back from it, but they're quite keen to work with us, whereby, you know, they could do maybe 80 locations across the UK and have that level of expertise there, which I think sometimes
fantastic.
Helps with the credibility of the next tier.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so if I think there's 3 tiers of expertise, the first tier, which everybody should do, and we should, you know, and then the second mid tier, which I think is your stuff, which is said sometimes it's hard to kind of taste a bit longer, and then there's the real kind of hardcore stuff. Sometimes those 2 tiers come together in the customer's mind, credibility wise.
We looked into that bit of like Geek Squad as an example to see what they're charging, and it's incredibly profitable industry to be into. I think they're currently offering a data transfer of like £15, which is great. I mean, if we wanted to introduce that to, say, external customers that aren't on a brand, then we could undercut that pricing by far. But some of the things that they charge is a massive amount, like £120 for screen repairs. So there's potential for us to undercut their pricing, but then still be profitable for ourselves. So it's definitely a revenue we could explore later with the brand.
Okay, brilliant, thank you.
I thought you did a great job. I thought your presentation was really comprehensive. You all shared it out. And I think that the other thing that I really noticed about you is whilst you had notes, you actually only referred to them at odd points. You talked without them, which says that, you know, your research and your passion is really difficult to present without, you know, referring to your notes. I thought you did a brilliant job. You just spoke from the heart. So very well done on that. A couple of questions. So you talked about 97% of customers that you did the exit survey said they would be interested. How many customers did you survey?
72.
Okay. Thank you. In terms of, I liked your different options that you maybe give to customers. How would you sell the concept of paying for the service to some of your customers?
So, do you want to
take
that?
Yeah. So that would be a conversation that the advisor would have with the customer. I'm going to talk about the protection as a whole. So obviously we want to go in and set them up with the insurance and protection with a full cover anyway. But if they didn't really want to do that, thought it was a bit more expensive, then that's the different avenue that we go down to.
able to recruit those people permanently in post to do that, or are you looking at doing it with secondments? How would you go about it?
It would start with secondments, and obviously we would have to go through and have a look at some advisors for the rollout and see if they would want to go on with. But we've kind of given ourselves a little bit of a gap ready to get them up to spec. That's why we started it at H2, so that we're not just rushing into it. We want to make sure they are dedicated to get the best results and the most clear results out of it. But it would be on a secondment basis, and that's how we would then gauge whether they're ready and if it's working, and then go forward. So it would be potentially other stores. It would be sort of stores themselves as well. A lot of reason that sometimes you have high performing MPS stores with high performing MPS because you've got someone in store that necessarily doesn't do as well on the figures but does great on the service. It's just something that we would look to explore because not everyone does want to sit there and have a target board behind them. They would feel a lot more relaxed and give a lot more to their job if they were just able to sit there, take their time, and go through and talk to people and sell their hands.
So I think
we
would probably have opportunity, especially when some of the things you touched on is about contact centres and retail working together. So I'm thinking if one of your top stores that maybe was going to go for this was actually Newcastle or closer to Greenock, we could actually maybe utilise seconding one or two of our own advice. I mean, it wouldn't work if we were down in London because we don't have any contact centres there. But there's something about it maybe being shared cost initially.
I echo everyone else's comments. Great delivery, really, really engaging. Thoroughly enjoyed it, and you were definitely very slick and all new stuff. So I think that worked really well. So well done. I think if you'd probably asked me before the presentation what do I think of the concept, I probably would have said that I want you all to be experts in the store. But actually, your insight did convince me that there's some mileage in some real expert people. So kind of well done for that, because actually kind of changed my mind and took me on that journey. So that was good. I think I kind of agree with the feedback that you've had in that you need to try some stuff out, and there's a temptation to do everything, but actually some stuff will be really powerful. We've certainly done some trials like this before, like sort of 4 or 5 years ago, when they were really, really successful. But what happened is really, really small amount, and so I think actually you guys have got a better idea already about what we should try. So I think we need to make some decisions on what's the biggest thing that will contribute to our number one service. The one thing I really agree with is for our customers, because the other networks are so visible with their expert, to not follow suit is a bit risky, because whether they ever feel like they're getting the same service. So I thought that was quite a good question that you raised. I'd probably ask you a question back, which is, if there's an expert in the store, so whether it be a trial or whether we rolled out, you've got an expert in the store who can do multiple things, what are the risks for the behaviour for the rest of the people in the store? And how does that risk our number one service plan or the other store?
I see a potential risk that the other guys in the store would offload a lot of their work onto the expert, which is why we would like to stick to the bookable appointments. If the expert is free and there is a huge queue in the store, absolutely the customer advisor could pass over to the e-expert in order to get a data transfer and whatnot done and a brilliant setup for them to move on to their next customer. But if it's a situation where it is quiet, that advisor should continue all the way through and do the brilliant setup. So I think the risk could be that the customer is being left at one person and moved on to another.
I was going to say also, if you were an advisor, their sort of point of view, it'd be silly to let that happen because you potentially risk your MPS because it's going to be your MPS result when you get back. This is affecting your commission and your job essentially. If you get a customer bait and or break because you just fob them off to somebody else, you can still get that in your verbatim saying, customer advisor just fob me off to the expert, is brilliant, still get 10 or something, but then that guy's getting marked down for a red, so you really would be a little bit, unwise.
I think the manager of the store would be able to kind of manage that, monitor that, make sure it's not happening.
And likewise, there'll be opportunity for you to upsell the data to that customer who might be eligible for an upgrade, and also we'll do digital devices in store, which might be useful for that customer to work with his current handset, basically. So, i.e., iPads, Wi-Fi, opportunity there where you can upsell to the self-advisor as well, which you can pass back to the self-advisor.
And I think that's probably the health check, I would be saying, with the plan is the Geek Squad and the OT Guru has been around quite a long time, and they're built on the way our customers used to behave. But see, now if it's kind of 43% of customers are walking the door walking for service, to have 10 people selling on one person being a customer expert, I'm not sure that proof of concept is proven today. So I think that gives EE a great opportunity to move the concept right into this year, our customers today, bring it right up to date and develop something new. The opportunity
we've got. Hopefully as well, you know, should it go into such a scheme of being rolled out to many stores, there'll be trainees, experts as well, so that relationship only is going to be enhanced within the store. Why would you sort of cut off your nose to spite your face? I want to be that guy, so I'm going to help him, and he'll help me.
Sure.
So. I thought it was good as well. It's like, just because you're not first to deliver a product doesn't mean you do it the best way. I mean, companies like Apple, who have Apple people myself, but they don't often bring new products to the market that haven't been done before, but when they do it to such a level of success and they are like the go-to point.
Yeah,
it's
a great challenge, yeah.
So we can do that.
Okay, Lee?
Yep.
Okay.
So again, very good delivery, very pretty presentation. Sure. Lots of megabytes on an email. But it was good to see the data looked into about the spot numbers of the data. Tee up to your session as well, it's very clear on a bit of background on where you're going, so well done on that. A couple of questions from me though. I've got a worry, I can't quite work it out, so the question back would be that you talked about packages for service. We're in a world moment where we're very service generated and we provide a service. How do you and when do you get to that point in a conversation where you go, sorry, sir, it cost you £15, whatever you're charging? How does that work? Not become a bad experience.
Yeah, so we have a 20-minute consultation for any customer that walks in the shop. That'll be explained at the initial discussion. So we say you get 20 minutes, a bit free to go through if you want. If you'd like some more than that, you can sign up for a subscription or one off your £20. So they would know initially how long they've got for this.
And that's the guru or the expert saying that initially.
If someone came in or if they came in to speak to an advisor, the advisor would let them know the situation.
I think just to add on that, if we do a software up-to-date store at the moment, that it's an old branded piece that we've got, but it's a disclaimer form that a customer signs.
Yeah.
So we could literally have it on that disclaimer form at the start to state that it's a 20-minute consultation, and should it overrun that there would be a £20 charge, and they would have to agree and
And do you guys feel compelled to monetize it, or you think it's the right thing to do to monetize it?
No, we did also look at if we couldn't fix it, we wouldn't charge it, send it to SBE. So if we can't facilitate the fix in store, monetarily speaking, nothing's free, really. Advice is free, ideas are free, but when it comes to phone and time is money.
And what our competitors are doing as well with charging, and it's working for them.
I think with your question, we'd all love to give it out for free as much as we could. I mean, in our minds, the service is the number one thing the customers come in for. But I think all customers do expect to pay for something eventually. So we would give that 20 minutes for free, and that would be part of EE's number one service. I don't think the other guru would do that sort of thing. So free, 20 minutes, yes. But I think customers do expect to pay for it, any service at the end of the day.
What we would really want from this flagship world is obviously to increase our insurance and protection service and really strengthen the product with it. If we're doing 20-minute consultations and we're not getting money from the customer, we're preventing a handset being sent away for repair, then we've not made money. We save £15, we've not made the money in that sense. And what we've seen as well is that it's a demand for customers that won't take insurance on the handsets, but as soon as their handset goes
that's a convenience and a speed and a pace rather than an interaction and a thing. And you know, I think, you know, I'm not so sure about.
If I may, on that one, with regard to focusing quite heavily on my phone's broken, it's an element, sure, really a huge element, but it's also about, right, I'm setting up a business, I want to do this.
Yeah.
I want to have my Dropbox account linked to my iPad so I can access my emails here, cloud storage. Not every query and service will repair will be an actual problem. It will be a how do I, potentially. And if you don't know, yes, you could Google it, but that's taking time out of your self-employed day to money you're not earning. Come in and see us. If we can sort you out in 20 minutes, happy days, then yeah, we'll discuss, maybe book another appointment when you're free and we'll look after you for that. So for someone to pay £20 to get a business then up and running and they can be in touch with their clients, to them that's priceless.
I think you touched on it, but it was almost like a bit of a secondary point to heart.
I think generally we are. Do you want?
I think.
Yeah.
So, generally, obviously, there's kind of like a circle of life. Somebody buys a phone online, comes to the store to send it off, then they get put on the phone, and it just kind of goes round and round. We're trying to eliminate that. So, if our guys could come into, say, somebody's bought a phone online, comes to the store, just needs to get it set up, we can do that for them. They need to change their address. You know, they've set it up to the wrong direct debit, they haven't set up a direct debit, serial.
Say to that is, do these people get targeted commissioned bonus? Because you assume the fact that there's a fixed salary and then the commission structure that's on top. This sounds to me like it's a little different. That's the semantic that we need to fall through.
We did.
Yeah.
We did look into them being bonus solely on NPS, and then the question arose is how do we measure that? So it would be, I know store support at the moment, when you phone through to store support, they'll take your mobile number and then you get an NPS tag. So I'm envisioning a similar sort of scenario, to take the system what store support use and to bring it into store, have the EX about having access to that system in order to
like the local stores will have the experts' telephone number. They can tweet, they can message, they can Skype, they can get in touch with them.
Great.
Potentially that will fix that little gap.
The remote device takeover that we use in CS actually looked within itself quite weak, and you know, it's pretty limited, isn't it? Somebody taking over your device from us is really good.
Yeah, there's definitely things that we're doing, like,
yeah.
So, good. And the final point for me, I really, the debate you just had about the 20 minutes and freebies and all that stuff with the EX, but I'd love to see something that was quite concrete that says your option is to be assisted in the second early because you can see our expert, and for roughly 20 minutes, what you're going to get to these three things. If you want any more than these three things, it might take 10 minutes to do this, it might take 5 minutes, we might want it at all. You're going to pay a sum, and that gives you all these other, more, kind of like you've got the set menu, or if you want to go off the set menu and have whatever you really like to eat, you can pick up here, and as you go. And that way you're giving absolute assurance to the customer that if they really want to have some of the basics, they'll get them free. If they've got the insurance product, they can have a bit more from the three or four items you can pick off the a cart menu. If you pay 20 quid, you can have the lot.
Yeah.
And it's kind of built. Forget time, because time becomes something that the competence of the expert might get one or two things through in 20 minutes, but might get seven or eight things through in 20 minutes. But the customer will sit there and say, I've got 20 minutes,
yeah.
You're going to charge me 21, I can see a stopwatch, and you've got to remove that time.
Absolutely right. For us, that probably the biggest headache of the whole thing. What do we charge? Do we charge? How long do we charge? What do you get for it? We had so many ideas. So yeah, that is a phenomenal idea. We'll certainly take that away.
I have one every month or two.
Thanks for sharing.